Anyway, here's my presentation. I was working with this article for months, and then I was working with a summary for weeks, and then I was starting doing overheads. And the first set was cancelled, and now I will survive. But speed is almost number one, I say, in importance. If you read any document, you will see that speed is so high up on the agenda. Because everybody has to say something nice about speeds. That's a simple question. But as I will show, it's a tremendous potential, and many hundred thousand lives every year that could, quoted, easily be saved. And still, almost nothing happens. You know the relationships, you are quite aware of, and they are very strong, and they are working on two aspects, the risk of accidents and the consequences of accidents. You see, UN and WHO and every organization is mentioning speed. And if you ask them, they will say that it's number one. It must be number one. And there are two aspects with regard to lowering the speeds. It's lowering the speed limits, and it's increasing the compliance with the speed limits, the prevailing speed limits. And I took the example of lowering the speed limit 10 kilometers per hour results in a 3 kilometers per hour lower average speed, which results in something like 9-10% fewer fatalities if you are on a 80 kilometer or 90 kilometer per hour road. While 100% compliance of the prevailing speed limits will result in something between 20 and 50% fewer fatalities. And then we are talking about hundreds of thousands of lives every year. But my main problem actually is the last sentence. What about low and middle income countries, which represent something like 90% according to Kitam's paper? Why? I don't know almost anything about what's going on in low and middle income countries. While they should be number one priority, of course. But I've looked and I've been looking at all the available data when it comes to speed changes. And in Europe, ETSC established 2006 the safety performance factor speed. 2006. And that is 12 years ago. And very poor follow-up I've written. And you can read in the article. And there are almost no reductions of speeds whatever, wherever you go in Europe. It's only France and Switzerland that sticks out, but they only present data for 3 years and so on. So it's not very impressive. And the same goes for US and Australia. Australia has a more steady downward trend, but only 0.3% per year, which means that it cannot at all follow the changes of fatalities. You know, it's too much too small for that. And I've been looking at Sweden because they had very nice data from a 20-year period from 97 to 2070. And compliance rate is steady, 45%. Compliance rate, non-compliance rate, 55%. All over the 20 years. And average speed is going down 0.2 kilometers per hour over the 20 years. And attitudes, I've looked a lot of attitudes. There is a European Sartre study, and there is every year a Swedish one. And the conclusion is rather simple, namely that attitudes are extremely swinging, and it can't be a basis for any normative work with speeds and attitudes. So, and you see the second example in the US driver's answer that it's unacceptable to exceed the speed limit by more than 20 miles per hour, more than 32 kilometers per hour. That is unacceptable, but up till that limit, it's fairly okay. And you see, Sweden does interviews every year, and drinking and driving is far more important than speeding. It's pointed out three times as frequent as speeding. And my last point is, as you see, lawmakers seem to agree, because sanctions are much stronger for drinking and driving than for speeding. And you can easily see that these attitudes, both among people and among decision makers, are rather solid, namely that drinking and driving is far more important. And now I'm going over to talking about the car regime, which consists of, in principle, all possible actors, as you see, car manufacturers, supply industry, car owner associations, media, etc. And since the 60s, 70s, speeds have gone up regularly regarding speed performance, of course. While speed limits since the 1970s more or less has been constant. So that's really a paradox, that speed performance is going this way and national speed limits are going no way, it's standing still. And in the 1990s, three promising trials with speed limiters in private vehicles was introduced, one in Sweden, one in Holland, and one in UK. And speed limiting in this way means that it's not possible to exceed the speed limit. You keep the speed limit as a maximum speed. And those trials, I am a bit biased because I was involved in the Swedish trial. But the results were quite promising. No big problems, speeds were extremely harmonized and so on. And people were very happy with it, but the samples was small and these people were new beginners. So they were, you know, focused a lot from media. So it's rather biased results, but the interesting thing is that in spite of the positive results, car industry said no. There will be no more research or trials regarding speed limiters in cars. So it was changed to what was called intelligent speed adaptation. And that stands for a voluntary system that so far has not proven to produce any reductions of speed. And you see the last, there are predictions that a speed limiter could reduce fatalities by up to 50%, while I say the voluntary thing is predicted to produce minus 18% of fatalities. So there has been no governmental action, but Euro NCAP, and I don't know about other NCAPs, but Euro NCAP has introduced the speed assist function. But it's interesting because this speed assist function consists of five different driver assist systems, which make the speed having a very small importance in that. And it's the only system that is voluntary. The only in Euro NCAP that is voluntary. If you have the system, it's working automatically, you know, all other Euro NCAP systems. But this one is voluntary. So all more and more car manufacturers now have speed assist systems, and they even have I seen lately, they have speed limiters, which is not it's not obligatory, it's a voluntary system. And media and car owner associations, I don't need to tell you, but there was rather strong relations between car manufacturers and media, and also the car associations. And in Germany, three car manufacturers have a gentleman's agreement to have a speed limiter in their cars that is 250 kilometers. And it's now overridden in more and more cases because BMW produced something that could make much more. So they introduced their own speed limiter to 305. And they said, but because people are driving that fast, we need to train them. So they had a training session with every driver that had that kind of car. But training sessions have never, you know, resulted in less accidents, but only a few. Comfort and speed, that's a big area. I am only pointing at the Mercedes-Benz fantastic magic body control, which controls the road surface in front of the car and eliminates humps, simply eliminates all rough surfaces. And I've not seen one single word about speed. And that is, of course, extremely interesting in that sense. How will people react and how will people behave when they have such a system that it eliminates the discomfort of the road? And there's one good chance of looking at that, and that is naturalistic driving that is coming, even though it's coming rather slow, I think, for different reasons. But I think that's fantastic event for us as safety researchers also, because it will make it possible to study the naturalistic, normal speed behavior. It will be possible to study critical behaviors like speed adaptation, you know, in critical events and so on. It's a fantastic tool. But so far I haven't seen that it has been used so much for that purpose. But I really urge that. Speed campaigns, if you look at the meta-analysis, you see that speed campaigns only have an effect of 4%. And it's going down year by 1990s and year 2000 and so on. The effect was going down. But instead, I'm pointing at speed cameras and section control with two speed cameras. And there's no doubt that speed cameras is one of the big things that have to be introduced in larger scale. But the problem is that we have not very much knowledge, general knowledge, about the effect of speed cameras. And when we don't know when it works and when it doesn't work. Section control is more efficient. Of course, it's almost 100% compliance, but you don't know the costs and effects. And then I'm pointing at traffic calming.
Chris, I'm going to have to ask you to wrap up because you've had okay. your 10 minutes, and in fairness to the speakers, I'd bring them to
okay.
the
future. Sorry, I'm taking, I wrap then to wrap up.
Yes. Very good.
No, I'm pointing at the infrastructure and IRAP as infrastructural things that is definitely on the agenda as well. And the last part here is speed and other qualities, and I think in a way that is the most interesting and important part of my presentation, because there are lots and lots of qualitative aspects on speeds and the relation to other aspects. Like I was talking about livability and noise, for instance, and fumes, emissions, and so on.
Okay, I have to cut you there. Thank you, Christian. Sorry, there's so much to talk about. But, will people get the packs in these?
They've got them. Are the papers?
Will they be included in the delegate pack or available
yes.
later?
Yes.
Right. Okay. So you can look at it. Thank you. Thank you. He's asking a lot.